The Reserve Bank on Friday announced new rules for the resolution of default loans, or bad loans as we call them. This circular has an interesting history. In its early avatar, issued on February 12, 2018, yes, 15 months back, the Reserve Bank said that one day's delay in repayment will be termed as a default. Among other things, it also said that all stressed loans above 2,000 crore rupees will have to be taken to the NCLT if not resolved in 6 months. The circular was struck down by the Supreme Court. And on Friday last, the Reserve Bank therefore announced a new version of that circular. Hello and welcome to our Indianomics special. I'm Latha Venkatesh, and with me is Ritu Singh, who is now standing by to take us through the key differences between the new circular issued on June 7th and how it differs from the old one that was issued on February 12, 2018. Ritu.
Well, Latha, you know, the biggest difference, of course, is that that one-day default rule has been done away with. A default, yes, is a default. One day's delay is a default. But instead of starting work on the resolution plan immediately, banks have now been granted a 30-day review period within which they have to come to a consensus and then, start working on the resolution plan within the next 180 days. The second biggest change in the new circular compared to the older one is the mention of insolvency and bankruptcy court, which, remember, was the heart of the Feb 12 circular, but now because of the Supreme Court order, it is not mandatory for banks to take that route if they fail to find a resolution at the end of the 180-day period. The third big change has come in the form of NBFCs, even small finance banks, now being made part of the new circular, which was not the case in the earlier circular. And this is something that the IBA also had brought up in its presentations to the RBI, which has now been adopted in the new guidelines. The fourth big change that has come about is the use of inter-creditor agreement to pass a resolution plan. This did not feature in the Feb 12 circular, but now all resolution plans must be passed under the inter-creditor agreement, which also makes way for dissenting creditors to get at least the liquidation value, if they choose not to go with the lender's, largely approved plan. The voting threshold, that has also been brought down. Do remember, the Feb 12 circular said that any resolution plan can be passed only if it is unanimously approved by all lenders. But in this circular, what RBI says is that if it's 75% by value and 60% by number of lenders, then that a resolution plan will be deemed passed. The other big change is a punitive measure in the form of additional provisioning that has been introduced, without the IBC and the fear of the company going to NCLT. What the RBI has tried to do is incentivize banks to speed up resolution by saying if you delay resolution beyond 180 days, there will be additional provisioning to the tune of 20%. And if that a resolution plan is delayed further to beyond 365 days, then that 20% will go up by another 15%. To 35%, and this will be over and above what the IRAC norms, of course, say, which is 15% for NPA provisioning. The other big change also is what happens in what situation can you upgrade an account? Earlier, the Feb 12 circular said that from the time of implementation of the resolution plan until such time that 20% of the principal debt is repaid, you can't upgrade an account back, but that has now been diluted in the new circular to 10%. These are the key differences, but this new circular is now also applicable to all borrowers of over 2,000 crore rupees exposure, which was the case in the last circular as well. For accounts between 1,500 and 2,000 crores of exposure, the guidelines will kick in from the 1st of January 2020. And for all accounts below 1,500 crore rupees, RBI is yet to come out with guidelines, so we're yet to see what happens. In terms of the additional provisioning, as I was mentioning earlier, 20% for beyond 180 days, and that comes up to 35% after 365 days. The key change really is incentivizing bankers, even without violating the Supreme Court order, is to use the IBC, where the new circular says that if you choose to go the IBC route, half of the additional provisioning can be reversed at the time of filing of the application with NCLT, and the full additional provisioning can be reversed at the time of admission of a case in the courts. So that, in sum and substance, is what the new circular is about. It is a diluted version, but it retains the essence of the Feb 12 circular, which is time-bound resolutions.
Okay, thank you very much for explaining that lucidly, Ritu. And now to discuss how this might pan out and whether it will be successful, in helping bankers resolve more cases. Prashant Kumar, the CFO and Deputy Managing Director at State Bank of India, joins us, as does R.K. Bansal, Managing Director at Edelweiss ARC, Asset Reconstruction Company. He's also formerly banker with IDBI. Bahram Vakil, founding partner of AZB and Partners, now the moving spirit behind this older and newer version of the Stressed Asset Resolution Circular. And Mr. Vijay Kannan, Chief Executive of the Indian Banks Association. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us. Mr. Kannan, well, first to you, because in a way you will be, you'll have already put in place an inter-creditors agreement under the Sashakt plan. Now, that inter-creditor agreement did not have this 75% and 60%, it had different numbers. So, one, do you have to tweak it? And two, now do you have to get more people to sign it? All the NBFCs, etc.
Latha, thank you. And the ICA earlier had stipulated something like 66% is what we said of those people who are signatories to the ICA. Now, as per the RBI circular of 7th June, as against 12-2 now, it is mandatory for those people who have to start a resolution to have an inter-creditor agreement entered into. So, to some extent, we are planning to have the ICA amended to include these provisions, as also.
But if you amend it, everybody has to re-sign it?
No, amend it in the sense that we may actually add one or two clauses, and then we'll ask those additional members to sign these particular additional clauses, which will effectively mean that they'll continue with the old ones. Because by and large, most of the provisions of the ICA remains the same. It's only one or two clauses.
Do you think you can quickly get this done?
I am quite hopeful that we will be in a position to do it within a week or 10 days. We have already started work on this, of trying to get what are all the additional documents. And one particular point is that all the persons into the particular resolution have to sign the ICA.
You don't have to sign it for every loan. One master agreement is okay?
Yes, that's exactly what we are planning, to have a master agreement. And for each and every case, they give you a letter saying that, yes, we are agreeing for this particular case. Therefore, it becomes some sort of a agreement, the master agreement and the annexure, to give what are the facilities, etc. Now, how do we go about? So, I am quite hopeful that more and more people will come. And then another thing which we had requested at the Reserve Bank of India is the addition of the NBFCs, which has been something which has been considered favorably. Because in a few cases, the NBFCs were part of the lenders, but were not on board because they were not part of the ICA also. Now, that will be a welcome feature. So, we expect a holistic picture to be taken by the entire lending
company.
So, you
have to ask the NBFCs to sign?
Yes. We do expect that they will also come on board, because after all, it will be into their interest.
Okay. Actually, let me get R.K. Bansal in, also invite Ritu Singh, who is going to join us in understanding the nuances of this circular. Mr. Bansal, I think the asset reconstruction companies are also lenders to some of the loans. You have bought some of the loans. Now, obviously, because you are not regulated, you are not mentioned in the circular. Will y'all have to be part of the ICA? Do you plan to be part of the intercreditor agreement?
Thanks, Latha. The existing ICA at that time, I think many ARCs were not a part. But this circular talks specifically for ARCs for ICA purposes. So it gives a reference to ARCs also. But technically, ARCs basically represent the banks on whose behalf the loan is bought by the ARC. Oh. Very rarely it happens that ARC also might have given a loan. So we have to see, we will examine that issue. Certainly, in the interest of resolution, we like to be party in that sense. If it helps the resolution, why not? But that could be maybe the case specific instead of a general ICA. But that we will discuss maybe with IBA and accordingly take a call.
Right. We also have Mr. Bahram Vakil, one of the architects of the IBC. Mr. Vakil, you know, keeping the Supreme Court order in mind, how do you read the new circular still trying to incentivize the banks to use the IBC route and yet not flout what the Supreme Court had said in terms of not giving blanket directions?
Yeah, thanks a lot, Ritu. I think you've said it perfectly. That was the whole idea. Naturally, given the Supreme Court order, there was no question of a direction, and therefore RBI has gone with the route of incentivizing. And also, you know, you've laid down the differences very, very clearly. I think also Mr. Kannan said the issue about NBFCs being included. I think that's also pretty critical because that was something which was not there in Feb 12. Mm-hmm. Other than that, I mean, just so hope for the best because clearly I think the market wanted and needs a pre-IBC resolution. The number of cases are so many that it can't be, if you leave it all to IBC, then it's going to clog the system. And as people have said, there are some which are better dealt with pre-IBC. So hopefully now this will achieve the purpose.
Okay, and now that's a hope that things will not be taken to the NCLT. Because if you took it to the NCLT, then you get a rollback of the provisioning. So you're, you know, you would rather have it in the NCLT. But before I come to that, Bahram, let me ask Mr. Prashant Kumar, how have you understood this circular, Mr. Prashant Kumar? Do you think, suppose an insurance company or a mutual fund has given loans, even small loans, subscribed to some debentures or bonds, they also have to sign the ICA? How will it work?
No, I think like what Mr. Kannan has just said, IBA would try to talk to all these agencies and whosoever signed the ICA. And I think like if it is mandatory for everybody to sign the ICA, then definitely we need to take the concurrence and then take the call on the basis of the individual case. Because at the time of a default, now there are three options. Either you go for the recovery path, you go for the resolution outside IBC, or you go for the resolution within the IBC. Now, depending on the prospects and depending on what type of, say, provisions, provisioning requirement you need to make, then I think the banks would take that call that what should be the preferred route.
Okay. Well, actually, I don't know who will have this data. Mr. Prashant Kumar, maybe you have. How many of the loans require, have been lent to by pension funds, mutual funds, you know, provident fund trustees? Is there a large number of loans in this 2000 crore plus category? Do you have, how much is the number of accounts, total amount, and any idea how many of them will require all these mutual funds and provident fund trustees also in the fray?
No, I think the first thing what we need to see that the cases which have been referred to IBC because of the mandate given by the 12th February circular, only those have to be reviewed. But the cases which has gone to NCLT by the bank on their own would continue in the IBC process. There is no need to revisit them.
But in total, Mr. Kumar?
But that particular data, I think, is still we need to say collect. Yeah.
Would you recall the number, you know, how many cases under Feb 12 you've already sent or, you know, are you are in the process of sending to NCLT? Perhaps those would be the cases where you would need a rethink?
I think we are still in the process of collecting the data.
Bahram, would you have any idea if the number of cases taken to the NCLT under the old circular, whether in any of those cases there are lots of provident funds and pension funds and mutual funds involved? So, you know, you have to kind of enlarge this agreement, this intercreditor agreement.
No, sorry.
You're not sure?
No, I don't know. In fact, all the other panel members, just a lawyer, the others will have a much better sense.
Oh, just a lawyer, okay. Mr. Kannan, what's your sense? Without getting backing from IRDA and PFRDA, will the pension funds and mutual funds, first of all, sign? And do you need them?
No, frankly speaking, you know, the number of cases where we feel that the PFRDA and pension funds would be involved in the earlier cases and the except the recent ones, which has happened in the last 7 to 8 months, almost a year, I don't think there are too many cases where, because they were already stressed about 2-3 years ago, and many of them either must have declared this as a default or they have not invested in them. Therefore, it's the case of the recent ones, the NBFC cases in the last 1 year, which could come up. But I don't think there are too many cases of that. There could be a few mutual funds which have invested in some companies which might go to the NCLT going forward. So we will have to find out whether we can request our regulator to talk to the, have an inter-regulator meeting and try to find out whether those people also can be asked to sign it. Because it's not a, the RBI cannot, if I'm not mistaken, cannot mandate them to sign the ICA in as much as they are under a different regulator. So I think we should like to request them also to come on board and sign the ICA so that we'll be in a position to come some resolution. But the number of cases may not be too many in the past, but going forward, that may be a few cases.
But you know, what was the inhibition on the part of several lenders that did not choose to sign the ICA last time around, which will change now, except for getting, of course, a regulatory
See, there was a feeling that ICA could not be successful mainly because it was 100% agreement to be done by all the bankers. And as you are aware, there are two cases which went to the under the ICA, which has been cleared by the overseeing committee appointed by the RBA. They are in various stages of implementation. And because of this 60-75%, it makes it much more easier for them to come on board. And wherever the people are going to have descending creditors, as you rightly mentioned, Ritu, they can probably get away with taking the liquidation value, which has been clearly mentioned. Whereas in the earlier circular, there is no such provision for the amount to be liquidation value to be given. This is almost on the lines of what is being proposed under the IBC, where a dissenting creditor can actually take away and get out with a liquidation value. And if the other lenders feel that there is a case for a proper resolution, it could mean the lenders will get the upside, whereas the person who actually exits may have to live with only the liquidation value. So that will be some incentive for people to feel that, okay, 60-75%, let's give it a chance. And but 60-75% is not going to be so easy also, because in case there's any further default, again the meter starts again. And RBI might, if you see the wordings, say that it will examine the cases if there is going to be any evergreening or some shortcuts being done, in which case they may actually go ahead and direct the bankers to take them to NCLT. One particular point which I want to say is there's an incentive and disincentive to complete a resolution. Similarly, incentive and disincentive to take it to the
NCLT.
NCLT. One of the reasons many bankers may not take it to NCLT is because of our experience has not been excellent. It's been okay in a few cases, but there have been cases where it's gone more than 643 days, so you have issues on that. And therefore, that is something which might encourage many bankers and the other lenders to come forward and see if there's a resolution. Another point is, under the NCLT, once you go, you have to necessarily, because of Section 29A, go for a new buyer, which could mean that if the existing buyer is in a position to get some investor, etc., and come in, and then jointly give a proposal, could be an encouraging feature.
Okay. Well, Mr. Bansal, actually several questions for you. First up, you know, do you think people will prefer the NCLT route or resolution outside? Because at least in the NCLT, when you take even a massive haircut, there is the NCLT stamp of approval. Outside it, you bankers are open to investigation. The CVC is always there, and the fear is that after your retirement, you're going to be dragged to court. Do you think bankers will still opt for NCLT and not outside NCLT resolution?
I think it depends, Latha, like what type of asset it is. I mean, coming to your earlier question, you were asking whether PF or insurance companies would have invested. 99% no, because these were project finance. And initially, in project finance cases, they are not able to invest because you don't get that type of rating. Except the existing companies which are working well and with their rating, there only perhaps some exposure can come. So coming back to your point, I think let us take a power sector. The maximum objection to this circular anyway was mainly from power sector. Not because of anything else. The basic objection was that why I am being forced to take this asset to NCLT, knowing perhaps well that in NCLT also I may not find a solution. In that case, I may end up having a liquidation which is unnecessary at this stage from country perspective and from overall perspective. I think this circular gives that flexibility that bank take a call. RBI is happy with making additional provision if you can't find a solution within 180 days. Mm. But you keep on making additional provision, and as Kannan Saab said, that you have incentive, disincentive. But my feeling is, so banks will take this call whether I should take this asset to NCLT, not just because of this fear of our investigation. I would say even the OTS or even sale to other institutions like ARC, they do in transparent manner.
Yeah.
So nowadays they use Swiss challenge method, they use the, I mean, sale to ARC, which is a normal auction process. So they are able to prove that we have followed a process. In that sense, I think they don't get too much worried. And especially I have seen the largest lender of the country today is taking a lot of such cases and trying to do. So I'm not really thinking that NCLT decision will be based on this only.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe a few banks do that, but otherwise not likely.